Good afternoon. My name is Vanessa, and I will be moderating the next proceeding with my friend in Zach. This broadcast is being carried out in a partnership with Biology Control Class from your entomology program, which is offered by professors Angelo Carlini and Madeleine Gervon. Today, the topic is statistical measures for finding the best natural range of Putabecolus. This is a topic of high relevance in entomological studies about the pest, and you have the chance to talk to an expert in this subject. So make sure your question is in the chat because it's going to be answered after the presentation. As usual, today's broadcast will be divided into two moments. In the first moment, the guest will be fully addressing the subject. And in the second moment, we will dedicate the space to the public, where the guests will answer the public's questions.
Welcome, my name is Isabel. Vanessa and I, we are moderating this broadcast. Now, we have the honor to receive a great Professor Wanda Bueno. Professor Wanda is graduate in biology at UNESP, master and PhD in entomology at the Salk University, and postdoctoral degree from the University of California in Berkeley. She's a professor at the Federal University of Labras in the state of Minas Gerais, visiting professor at entomology and ecology department at the South University, and collaborator professor at Wageningen University in Netherlands. She has experience in agronomy area with an emphasis on agriculture entomology interaction, and she has extensive experience with augmented biology control, pest biology control, incorporations, selection and evaluation of predators like Heteroptera, mass production and quality control. The augmented biology control has become an important component for sustainable crop production because it serves as an effective alternative when naturally occurring enemies are not sufficiently abundant or effective. Today, Professor Wanda is going to talk about the extremely relevant topic. Professor Wanda, now it's with you.
Okay, everybody, thanks a lot for inviting me for this presentation. I would like to say thanks to Madeleine and Angelo for to be part of this project in this course. Continuing what Professor Valentin speak last week, I will do an example how to really find a specific procedure for finding the best natural enemy. And for this, we choose one important pest that is tomato pest, Tutabisoluta. We know that Tutabisoluta originates from West South America and is very important pest in all over South America. And if not controlled, no control is used for this pest, they can cause very big damage because they attack not only the plants, but also the fruits. And this pest invaded Europe in 2006 and causing a lot of problems in tomato crops. And in nowadays, we can see that Tutabisoluta is all over the world and almost all continents has this pest. But in case of Brazil, if you talk in case of Brazil, tomato is an important crop, but we don't have only Tutabisoluta as an important pest. We have another pests like whitefly, several species of lepidopterans, leaf miners, aphids, mites, and thrips. Then, when we think about to find a natural enemy of Tutabisoluta, we have also to think what may be the best natural enemy for Tutabisoluta Tutta Absoluta, and the other pests. Then, this is an important question, because as I say, tomato has many other pests besides Tutta Absoluta. Then you think about the generalist egg parasitoid like Trichogramma, that we know that Trichogramma can act on eggs of Tutta, but we know that no effective for control of Tutta and the other pests. Then you think about the specialist larval parasitoid, not effective for control of the other pests also. Then you think, what about the generalist predators? Yes, because they may kill other pests that occur in tomato. Based on the big success of happen in Europe with the use of myriad predators, we decide also look for this kind of natural enemy if they can act here also in Brazil, because we know that 2 points is important. We cannot import predator bugs from Europe. It's not a realistic option due to the access benefit sharing issues. So we search for locally occurring natural enemies to prevent potential environmental problems with exotic pests. Then we decided to collect predators in the field in Brazil. We already know that if you think about predators, mainly we know that we have the report about the Oryx insidiosus and the Geocoris punctips, that they attack and consume Tutta Absoluta eggs and the larvae. Then we decided to see about another predators and thinking about the myriad, like I said, based on the success of myriad in Europe. Then we sampling on tomato crops, wild plants, and tobacco, and we find, among others, 3 myriad species: Campylonops infomatus, Macrolophus basicornis, and Engitatus varius. Then, the second important question, if you have these species, what characteristics should an efficient predator for control of Tutta Absoluta have? Should be able to walk and reproduce on tomato? Should not cause damage to plants and fruits? Should kill sufficient prey? Should be easy and cheap to mass produce? And should kill Tutta Absoluta and the other pests that we have in tomato? Then we start for the first question. Should be able to walk in tomato plants? We know that tomato is a plant that has trichomas, and trichomas not only in the stems, but in the leaves, they have mainly glandular trichomas, which can catch pests and natural enemies. And we know that the glandular trichomas excrete a stick exudate. We find that the Oryx insidiosus, for example, they can prey larvae and eggs of Tutta Absoluta. But we saw by the experiments that Oryx cannot really walk on the tomato plants. They are catch by the trichomas glandulares. And related to the reporter related to the myriad, we find that the myriad are a kind of the specialist insects to plants with trichomas. They have a kind of avoidance strategy of myriads on sticky plants, may interact with an early sensor defense strategy by rupturing fewer trichomas than other arthropods. For example, works by Vogue Gorbri with the myriad Dicyphus errans. Also, not only the legs of the myriads are important for avoid the trichomas on tomato, but the size of the body, they can be, even these species that are slender, like their body bugs, use long legs to hold their bodies above the glandular trichomas. Or if the body is more, they are more heavier, they contact the sticky exudatus, but they are able to slow the exudatus using an anti-adhesive epicutular grace layer on the cuticula. This made the myriad as an important, like I say, a kind of the specialist to avoid the trichomas on the plants. Based on this, we tested, for example, our species, the three species that we collect here in Brazil, and we saw, we tested two different lines of plants, of tomato plants, and these plants had different density of the trichomas. We saw that no, the way, the behavior about predation or searching time was not affected by the quantity of trichomas. There were some difference between the species, but not related to the density of trichomas. Another point important that we talked before, it was these myriad are able to reproduce on tomato plants because we think about establishment of this on the plants, what facilitate also this establishment. And the, also experiments show that they develop very well and they accept the tomato plant as a host plant because the myriad, we know that they use the plants for oviposition. And you can see by this table that also the three species related to development, fecundity, longevity, and the RM was, they show that this myriad was able to reproduce on tomato plants. Also the oviposition, we tested how was the choice for oviposition, also in different parts of the plant, of tomato plants. And we find that the middle part was the preferred for the oviposition of eggs. And this is very interesting because Tuta absoluta normally prefer also the upper or middle part for lay their eggs. And this can be a good match for the predators taking the eggs of Tuta absoluta. But another important point is myriad are classified as zoophytophagous. And this maybe sometimes can be problem if this myriad can use the plants not only for oviposition, but they can just take the plant as food, for example. And this can damage the plants like the European myriads do. And this was a very important problem that we have to face it when we think about myriads. Because in this slide, for example, the damage caused by Nesidiochoris tenens, that it is one of the species that they use in Spain for control, tuta absoluta, the damage, if the population of this myriad increase, the damage in the plants can be very hard and it can affect the yield of the tomato. Then we decide also to see what happened with our species here, and then we tested nymphs and the adults of the three myriads related to their damage, not only in the plants, but it also in the fruits of tomato. And then we find that there are some damage we call necrotic rings on the seedlings of the tomato caused by the nymphs, but for the other side, the seedlings develop normally without a problem due to the presence of the nymphs. Then we test also the adults, and we find out that the adults cause even less injury than nymphs to the seedling plants. And related to the fruits, nymphs also cause the feeding punctures on tomato fruit, but even lower numbers than on the leaflets. And we saw the punctures disappeared and the adults no feeding punctures. Then we concluded that these three South American species that we find here, they are polyphagous. They cause some necrotic rings on tomato leaflets and feeding punctures on fruits, but cause no yield and quality loss, and seems much lesser damage than the European species. The other point that we think about, are they easy and cheap to mass produce? Because when you think about a natural enemy, you think about how I can use this natural enemy. And we find out that these three species are very easy to rear. We use as a food Hephaestia cunealis eggs and the tobacco plants as oviposition substrate. And the other point, they kill enough prey, they kill really another prey than tuta absoluta. And we make a kind of a comparison between the species that they are using in Europa with the Brazilian myriads that we collect here. Then we survival of eggs and nymphs are similar or better than European species. The total nymph predation the species in Brazil is around 350 tuta eggs. And total nymphal predation the species in Spain is around 160 tuta eggs. You can see that is more than double that they can eat eggs. Consider the total adult predation, the species, one species in Brazil, for example, Macrolophus brasicornis, is around 1,000 tuta eggs. Other important issue that we find is related to sex ratio. The two species, Enguitatus varius and Macrolophus basicornis, the sex ratio is 50% females. Is good. But Campylobacter infomatus, we find out more than 80% females. We consider good, but we didn't find yet what really caused this difference of the sex ratio in infomatus. This is one point that we need to do more observation and more experiments. Then, all data up to now, we conclude that the tree Brazilian perform better than European species. Like I said, they kill eggs and the larvae of Tuta absoluta. They go to the mine where the larva it is, and they really kill the larvae also, not only the eggs. This is very important that they kill not one stage, but the two stages. Like I said before, Tuta absoluta is not the only pest that we have in tomato. Then we ask the question again, kill Tuta and the other pests on tomato? Like we said, I have a lot of another pests in tomato and many potential natural enemies for these pests. But if you see by this table, for each pest, basically you have one different natural enemy. In total, you see that for this table, we can see that we can have the 15 to 25 species of natural enemy. This will be realistic for a biological control program. If you have one program, each pest, you have one species or two species of natural enemy. Then we think about this, we made several trials testing the myriads about the other species that was related in tomato, not only Tuta absoluta. Then you can see that all the others that we test, like Benicia, Helicover parmigera, or aphides, or another Lepidopteran prestis, we see that myriads are involved with this another pest of tomato. And this, if you see, if you remember the table before, we thought about 15 or 25 natural enemies. Using the myriad, for example, you decrease this number for 1 to 5 natural enemies. This could be one program when you have several pests killed by one species of natural enemy. But of course, we see that the tree myriads accept a wide range of prey, but we need to test more prey species. Another point important is they reduce Tuta absoluta population. And the trials that we did during our observation with this myriad, we tested them in a greenhouse, experimental greenhouse. In the first trial that we did, we really see that the two of the three myriads also significantly reduce tuta absoluta population in experimental greenhouse. Then you could ask, but what about the another one, Enguitatus varius? We believe that there were some problem with this, but we are able also to solve this because we don't believe, we really believe that something happened during the trials. This species was released in the greenhouse, but they disappeared the greenhouse. It's because I'm saying that we see only about these two species that are really control the pests. Another release that we did only using, for example, Macrolophus basicornis, we released two couples per plant in the third week of the tomato in greenhouse experiments. And we can see very easy that the treatment, when you have only tuta absoluta, the population was very high, and you you release the Macrolophus basicornis, you have the control of the population. Here you can see better related to the weeks of the development of the tomato, and you can see the control above is very clear. The Macrolophus basicornis was important for control the population of the tuta absoluta. And another important point that we find out related to the climatic change, climatic matching, we see that the trimerid species and the tuta absoluta have a perfect climatic matching. Then the remarks about these trimerid is like I present before, we say that the laboratory performance data of these trimerid are better than the European species. They do not seem to cause damage through phytophagia. They have a wide prey spectrum. Two of the trimerid significantly reduced tuta absoluta numbers in an experimental greenhouse. But we observe the other experiments that very good performance of Macrolophus basicornis and the climatic matching with tuta absoluta. And now we are waiting for tests under commercial greenhouse conditions are urgently needed and planned. Then the message about mirid, because I think in Brazil, mirid are still, not only in Brazil, but South America in general, there are not too many information about these predators. And I think that is important to start to think about these predators, that they could be a very important natural enemies like they are using now in Europe for biological control. They are generalista, but they have a broad prey menu. They are specialist in dealing with trichomas on tomato. This is very important because most of the natural enemies just cannot afford this because they are catch by the trichomas. And the recent paper by Paris et al. In 2008, mirid has the capacity to induce defensive plant responses due their phytophagous behavior. They activate the production of secondary metabolites and proteins that have toxic repellent and or antifeeding effects on herbivores. On the other hand, they can induce plant resistance. This is a very important issue that should be explored more this related to this species. I would like to finish my presentation and just to say about one book that we just published now, Biological Control in Latin America and the Caribbean, It's Rich History and Brief Future. All the biological control areas, what's going on in biological control in Latin America is in this book. Any information, please mail to me and I will be glad to send you the information. Thank you a lot. Muito obrigado. And I really would like that we can, in the future, to be together. I can see you. You can see me. We can exchange our experience and not be really like now. We are so far. I cannot see you, but thank you for to listen me for this presentation. Any doubts, let's go to talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Wanda. You can see us? Can you see us? Okay. At this point, we will move on to questions asked by the asked by public.
Okay.
The first question asked by Madeleine Vezon is, how about combined use of trichogramma and myriad for tuta control?
Yeah, we have a paper. We just did this experiment in greenhouse. We used trichogramma pretiosum and the Macrolophus basicornis. We are just analyzing the data. And we can see that it's a good matching. You can use trichogramma in the first point because trichogramma is related to the eggs also. And the paper showed that it's a good match. You can use trichogramma and Macrolophus. But we could see that the trichogramma is important, but you have to release a lot of numbers of trichogramma in order to have you have a control. But the myriad, you only use two cups of myriad per plant. This is a kind of things that we are discussing in the paper. I think this year the paper will be published.
Thanks, Professor Wanda. The next question, please. Madeline asks, do you mirror the species tests field on pollen?
No, we didn't test, but our experience showed that myriad are not related to pollen. They go to the plant, but they go for some water, not the pollen. We didn't see really that the myriad are related with pollen. Like I said, myriad are very, we don't have too many information until now, but I don't see that pollen is important for myriad.
Thank you, Professor Wanda. Next question is asked by André Barroso. And are myriad bugs used for augmentation biological control or just in conservation and natural biological control? Also, are there cases of these bugs becoming pests that needed to be controlled?
Yes, the first question, MIRI-DR use as augmentative biological control. They are using in Spain, for example, and in other countries, they are using MIRI-D as biological control agent. But the species that they have there, like in Nesidiocordis tenuis, several other species can be found and can be important as in conservation biological control. Classical biological control, I see that is, in our days, is a little bit difficult, like I said, because of the Nagoya Protocol, you import or you have problems in, you can do, but like several companies ask to us to export these MIRI-Ds from Brazil, but we are not so far think about that because of the issue of Nagoya Protocol. And the third question is, if they are, what's the third question, please? He made three questions. I think I answered two. Okay. Yeah. There are cases of this bug become pests that need to be controlled. Not really pest, well, can be. In case of Spain, they are having problems now with Nesidiocordis tenuis. And in Holland, for example, they become pest if Nesidiocordis reacts such population that they cannot have more tuta or another pest for use as a food, then they go to the plant and they cause really problem to the plant if not controlled. And in case of Spain, they are using some techniques to avoid the high population in tomato. For example, they release Nesidiocordis before to go to release on the greenhouse. For example, they release in seedings plants, tomato seeding plants. Then when the Nesidiocordis become established, they go to the seedling, go to the normal greenhouse for growing the plant, and then the population of Nesidiocordis start immediately to have tuta or another pest, and then this way they can control a bit the population of Nesidiocordis. But in case that the population escape, they can be very damaged. They can damage the plants of tomato. But for the other side, it's amazing what you see there. The growers are so happy with Nesidiocordis because Tuta Absoluta and because Bemisia also, because important pest in Spain, like in Brazil, is Bemisia tabas. And then they are so happy with Nesidiocordis that you can control this pest, this important pest. And they really, I saw one time, one of the growers, he really started to cry if you go to control the population of Nesidiocordis with a chemical control. It's a kind of two points that we have to really find the balance between. They are very good natural enemies, but they have this kind of things. Then we have to do the balance. What really is the benefits of the natural enemy, but they have this zoophytophagy. But related to our species, like I said, they really don't cause problems in the greenhouse experiments that we did also. They were not causing problems to the plants. Depends, I think, the each species and how they deal with the plants and how they deal with the prey.
Thanks for your answer. The next is Madeline. How about competing of millet with other natural enemies? Are there studies about?
Like I said, only a few studies, but since that they are compatible with several other species of natural enemy, but no too many studies, is an open field. Maybe, Madeleine, you can start to work on this.
Thank you, Professor Wanda. The next question. Asked by Eduardo Constantin. Very nice presentation, Wanda. It has been studied why the neotropical myriads do not cause much damage on tomatoes such as the European myriads?
No, because now, basically, we only know myriad from Europa, the species that they collected there, and our species that we collect here. No more data about the other species or how this was deal with this. It's an open field. You have to, it's a lot of, still a lot of questions that you can answer. But you have to study, to do experiments about this.
Thanks, Professor Wanda. The next question, please. Bruno Franklin asks, are there reports or integral predation in these natural enemies of tomato pest?
Intraguild predation, you can find it. There is one paper that was published by Herban Messling. He's a professor now in Wageningen. And he deal with this, what's going on with intraguild predation. Maybe if you send me your email, I can send you the paper and you can see more about intraguild predation of myriad. He is studying this part of myriad.
Thank you, Professor Wanda. Next question. Mayara Picanso asked, thanks for your presentation, Wanda. Is it possible to these myriads in the future could cause problem on crops once the variety of prey are reduced or when the prey population reduces?
Yeah, this is the point, because in a way, when decrease normally the generalist predator, when decrease the main pests, for example, if they don't have another prey, they have to survive, and their survival is related to the plant. This is a thing that we have to see in the future with these species. Until now, these Brazilian species, we see that they are not causing problem to the plant, because they have a wild broad, they have a very large scale of the other preys that they are related. And another point that I should say also, there is still a kind of The people are afraid maybe to use predators because predators normally are generalist. They can take a lot of another pest, but when they think about the biological control program, they think about more specialized natural enemy like the parasitoids, for example. They are more specialized. But as we see, we made some experiments when we test several pests in tomato. We tested the myriad, if they eat this pest, we saw clearly, for example, that these three species, they prefer in all cases that we put together with other pests, they really prefer eggs of Tuta absoluta. They eat eggs Tuta absoluta compared to the another eggs that we put together in choice or no choice. But it's, we should say that really, we don't know. We have to, like I said before, we have to go case by case and see in loco what's going on when you release this species. Until now, we didn't see any really problem in releasing these natural enemies, these three myriads, that, like I said. And in case of Inguitatus, for example, in Mexico, they are using now for control an important pest that they have there in tomato, that is a psyllid. We don't have this psyllid here in tomato in Brazil, but they are using Inguitatus variants as a natural enemy for this psyllid. I think the afraid to use myriad, it's not so afraid. People are not so afraid now because they see that they are important predators. They go and they eat and they do what they have to do.
Thanks, Professor Wanda. The next question is from Carlos Alves. Thanks, Wanda. Does this damage caused by myriad bugs, even if there is no reduction in the quality of the tomato, may farmers try to avoid using so phytophagous predator in a BC program?
Like I said, the people from the growers from Spain, they are not afraid to use. They are using, even knowing that they are in case of nesidiocoris, they are causing problem. They are using.
Thank you, Professor Wanda. The next question asked by Tadeu Souza. Why trichogramma is not effective to control of Tuta absoluta? Because in some situation, I think we need to control the pest before causing mines and drilling fruits.
Yeah, in fact, I don't say that is not effective to control Tuta absoluta. Like I said before, it's not effective to control Tuta absoluta and another pests. Like I said, the trials that we did matching together Tuta absoluta and myriad was okay. Trichogramma control, heavy controlling. But if you say that you have to use trichogramma first for the pest control before the it's not true, because in case of myriad, they eat the eggs also. They are crazy about the eggs of Tuta absoluta. If you have enough population, like they do in Spain, like they release before they establish the miridi, when the miridi go to, when the seedlings go to the normal greenhouse for plants growing, you already have the miridi there. They already started to eat tuta eggs, assume tuta eggs is, they have the ovoposition. And it's not, you are not, you don't need to use it to trichogramma first to kill the eggs. The miridi can kill the eggs also before the eggs develop.
Thanks, Wanda. The next question is from Joe. What is the problem with the Nagola protocol? Please explain what one needs to do in order to be able to spore another enemy.
Wow, Professor Valentre, you should ask this question, not me. You know better about the Nagoya Protocol. I just say that it's difficult. It's not a real problem, a Nagoya Protocol, but it's more difficult. The problem with Nagoya Protocol that I understand it's related to the agreement between the countries, and the countries can have the royalties by the biological material that they export or not export. And in case of Brazil, if you export the natural enemy, the country that receives this has to pay to Brazil for the natural enemy. I think this can be a kind of things, but for the other side, if you have the if you have the pest, for example, you get tuta. We didn't, you did, how do you say, no royalty because you get tuta, but you have to pay royalty because you needed the natural enemy of tuta. This is unfair, no? I don't know if I answer your question.
The next question. Thank you, Professor Wanda. And Madeleine Vezon asked, what other important pests in other crops do you think have the potential to be controlled by miridis?
Okay, we test until now, we test basically only in tomato crops, but some pests that can be in other crops. We test basically all the important pests like Phytorimeo perculella, like Neulocynodes elegantalis. In case of Neulocynodes elegantalis, is a very important pest in tomato in Brazil. You know, now they intercept Neulocynodes elegantalis in Holanda. And like tuta was exported to all over the continents, you have this, Helicoverpa parmigera. We test Helicoverpa parmigera, we test Phytorimeia, we test Neulocynodes, we test aphids, two important aphids like Macrocyphon euphorbi, Missus persis, but miridae are not so, they kill the aphid, but they are not so, they don't prefer too much aphid. But we have news about the trials that they did, for example, Macrolophus pygmaeus. They can use for control aphid in sweet pepper in Holland.
Thanks, Professor Wanda. The next question is Andrei Masoshi. Do you know of any research that snowing potential of myriad bugs for control of other insect pests?
Other, what you mean, other insect pests? I told that they are now using basically only for control Tuta absoluta, but now there are several used also for control Bemisia tabaci, and Bemisia can attack several plants. But one important thing I think that I told about myriad is there. There are they are able to walk on tomato plants. The other natural enemies normally is catched by the trichomas, and trichomas is very important and very stick on tomato, and when we find that the myriad can just for them is not a barrier. They just go for plants that have trichomas. They prefer plants that have trichomas. And this is an important also issue because in fact the other natural, we don't know. Basically, we don't know another species of natural enemy that are not really catched by trichomas. If you know, please tell me, because until now we didn't find that there are any parasitoid or maybe mites, I don't know, or that are not catching by. Trichoma can be important not only for the herbivores, but also for the natural enemies. And we didn't find as in case of myriad, the trichomas are not a barrier. I think this is an important issue also related to myriad.
Thank you, Professor Wanda. The last question asked by Diego Silva is, very nice presentation, Wanda. Do you believe that the mass production costs is a problem for implementation of myriad in Brazil?
Hello, Diego. Nice to hear from you. I don't believe that the costs of mass production is a problem for implementation in Brazil. I really don't believe it because, like I said, I think you have the experience also. I think maybe they are very easy to, it's not so difficult to produce. Then the costs, if you say, but they use eggs of Anagasta, and this may be a problem because eggs of Anagasta is very expensive. But maybe the problem with the food. But as I say, the other companies, they have their mass production and no problem with the mass production. I really, I think not. In my opinion, I think it's not, this is not a problem in Brazil about the implementation of the mass reining custo. I think the problem in Brazil, it's, Brazil has, how do you say, only tradition now, it's using microbiologicals, using fungi or for example, you have four millions of hectares of in Brazil is using parasitoids or predator, more parasitoid, because this 4 million I consider only basically Cotesia flavus or sugarcane. I think this is one problem for implementation of biological control using predators or parasitoids in Brazil. Now the big amount of the biological control that is happening in Brazil in areas around the 25 million of hectares is microbiológicos, no macrobiológicos.
Oh, thanks, Wanda. Now, we have some comments that we would like to show you, Professor Wanda. Joe Baulin, success, Professor Bueno. Madeline, welcome, Wanda.
Thank you.
Next, Joe Baulin. Nice to hear you speaking, Wanda, but I don't really see you for more than 10 months. When you come to Holland?
This is not permitted here. We are in a presentation.
Thanks a lot, Wanda, for such nice.
Thank you, Madeleine. I hope next time we will be together. We are talking together in the not this way. This way, wow, I feel so alone here.
Livia, very nice presentation, Wanda, and congratulations.
Livia, thanks. Nice to hear from you also. Saudades.
Flávio Montes, parabéns.
Flávio. Thank you, Flávio.
Simone Martinez.
Wow. All my students, you see? All my students. Simone. Very nice to hear also.
Congratulations.
Okay.
We are thank Professor Wanda for her brilliant participation. Now we are ending this afternoon broadcast. We inform that this video will be available on our YouTube channel. Do not forget to subscribe to the attendance list on the link in this video description.
We thank you for attending this event. Our lecture cycle will continue with the Professor Patricia Goller and the trainees fungi and nematodes as biopesticides. You are welcome to join us and you can get a certificate. Good afternoon, everyone. Take care.
Thank you very much for everybody.